Malthus had the same theory, right? Malthus's model is the same model we have on the board. Malthus has a model, his equations basically are delta GFP equals SL delta W plus SK delta R. Right? And he's got, so that's his view of the world, and delta W minus delta R equals 1 over sigma delta K minus delta L plus delta B. That's Malthus's theory. Except for Malthus's theory, he had a very different theory of supply. Malthus's theory of supply was delta W equals 0. His theory of the world was, if the real wage rate went up, people would just have more kids, and they would just keep having more kids until the return of labor went back down to where it started. That was his theory of the world. You can see it's the same model. It's no different. It's the neoclassical growth model with the role of labor and capital just flipped. His view of the world was, if productivity improved, we became better at growing food, then that would make people richer. And when people got richer, they'd have more kids, they'd live longer, population would grow, and we'd just have more and more people until we got back to being starving again. That's what would stop us from increasing health relative to cash. Because in his world, K was very inelastically supplied, and L was very elastically supplied, the exact opposite of the neoclassical growth model. Which, for his model, kind of makes sense. Because in his model, what was K? K was land. And the second part was that fertility, that is population, would have a very positive response to income. That if people got richer, they'd have more kids, and population would grow. Since K was fixed and L would grow in response to productivity, he said, well, we'll always be poor. Because however productive we get, we'll have enough people to make us poor again. Okay? Neoclassical growth model says, no, that's not how it works. In the neoclassical growth model, population isn't very responsive to the wage rate, and the limit is unresponsive to the wage rate. But importantly, capital is perfectly elastically supplied in the long run. So if you become richer, if you double the return to capital and double the return to labor, then you can't sustain that high return to capital. People are going to invest in capital. They're greedy. They want to make money. They're going to keep investing in capital and keep increasing the capital stock until the return to capital comes back to where it starts. Exactly the Malthusian model with the role of capital in labor reversal. Now you might say, well, why was Malthus so stupid? Well, he wasn't so stupid. I mean, that model has worked for 1,000 years or something. I mean, he had a pretty good empirical database to draw on. That he felt like, we got more productive, but we just always had more people whenever we got more productive. What really changed was, one, capital became a different kind of capital, a capital that we could invest in. And number two, people changed. And they didn't just have more kids. Now, we're going to turn it in a minute to say, well, that doesn't mean they didn't invest more. That when the return to people went up, that they didn't have more investment in people. They just didn't have more investment in numbers of people. They had more investment in the quality of people. And when we talk about income, we measure it per person, not per quality-adjusted person, right? So it's a very different notion of income. That's going to get us into the notion of human capital. And that's where I'm going to go next, is to talk about human capital and bring human capital into the growth model.